This is Solo Travel Talk. Your solo travel advisor is Astrid Clements.
You got the time off, you made all the plans, and now here you are, traveling the world, and you get sick. What a disappointment, but fear not. Your solo travel advisor, Astrid Clements, has some tips for you about staying healthy, fending off bugs, and even dealing with a health emergency when you are traveling. I'm producer Catherine O'Brien. Let's turn to Astrid to get some healthy tips for staying in the pink while we're traveling. Astrid, I thought we could organize your health tips into the good, which would be sort of pre-trip or preventative tips, the bad, getting sick, and the ugly, an actual health emergency. What are some of your preventative or health-supporting tips for travelers?
Well, Catherine, I'm so excited about sharing my tips and best practices on health safety when traveling, because this really is one of the most overlooked but key areas that solo travelers must address, or I feel you must address. As you said in the intro, getting sick abroad is no fun, and really, it can easily severely hamper or ruin a travel adventure. So please don't overlook this travel concern, even if you're in optimal health, because pre-trip health precautions, while you're on your trip, health solutions, and God forbid, a serious health event game plan are all wise preparation strategies to ensure that you enjoy your trip and you arrive home safely. Okay, now these are my or Astrid's pre-trip health abroad tips. First of all, make sure you're in good health before you take a trip. This is really important. You need to be in fairly good or good physical shape when you travel, just because you're going to be going to a different place with different germs. You'll probably be walking a lot more if you're an American citizen who doesn't walk enough anymore. And there are a lot of things that can affect you that will affect your health. So get in good shape or be in shape. Walk more, because when you're there, I guarantee you, you will be walking a lot more. And you might even be in a different altitude. And can really affect how you feel and could actually make you sick. The next thing is get a physical checkup, especially if you haven't had one in a while, just to make sure that everything is okay, especially if you're an older traveler. Get the doctor to write your prescriptions and an extra dose of meds in case you would lose some or whatever. But if you do take meds, you've got to get your prescriptions filled. Get a handwritten copy of those prescriptions. When you are packing, make sure you bring your bottles the pills are in, because if you don't put them in the bottles, sometimes you might have some problems, maybe even going through some type of security or something. You never can tell. So it's very good to not only bring the copy of the prescriptions handwritten from the doctor, but the actual bottles that the pills are in. Also, make sure you write down the name and address of your doctors. And what I suggest is that you write down a lot of this information in your journal, or I'll be going into a health check list, basically a packing list, that you could use that list and then also write the extra information on that. But I'll get to that in a minute. So, those are the things that you need to do before you leave. Also, there are two great websites that give you all the information that you need about traveling to a particular country. First of all, the website that I'm always quoting on the podcast because it's so wonderful is the U.S. State Department travel website. And basically, that URL is travel.state.gov. But this is wonderful because for every country, they have a specific section that's entitled Your Health. And the information is really great. They share with you the general state of healthcare where you're traveling, whether it's U.S. standards or below U.S. standards. They also tell you whether the healthcare providers will accept U.S. health insurance, Medicare, or Medicaid payments. A lot of countries do not accept that, and you need to know that. Whether you have to have cash up front payment is required if you have some type of services. They also recommend on this site insurance providers for overseas coverage and supplemental coverage recommendations, like the Med Evac or Air Evac services. A lot of people think, oh, I don't know about that. You know, and they're weighing with what they want in their travel insurance for the medical and health wise. I always get the Med Evac if I'm going number one to a third world country. Europe is not so necessary, especially in the big cities, because they have great hospitals and great health care, and they can get you somewhere in that city that will stabilize you if something happens and you're not close to one of the real good hospitals. But the medical evac is so key, especially if you go into any country that the services are not on par with the U.S. Also, they recommend doctors in clinics and hospitals that are U.S. standard, which is very important to know. They talk about different food and water quality, and also if there are any prevalent diseases at the time, whether it's Zika or bird flu, whatever. So you get a good, clear overview from the U.S. State Department travel website in their health section about what's going on. Now, then the other website is the Center for Disease Control. This is the best. I mean, the U.S. State Department is excellent, but the Center for Disease Control, it's fabulous. And it has a whole section on travelers' health and is organized country-specific again. But it gives you all the minutiae, up-to-date list of all the vaccines or vaccinations, immunizations that they recommend or that are required before you travel. Because some are required and some are recommended. Plus, they'll let you know you have to have had these vaccines 4 to 6 weeks ahead of time to make sure they work, or some of them are even longer. For safety food habits, they go into all the things that you really need to be careful about in terms of fruit, making sure that it's peeled, that the eggs and meat and fish that you eat is well done. Pasteurized dairy products. Don't take chances with the dairy products in some of the countries. And what they recommend in terms of street food vendor precautions, because so many travelers love to just buy something off the street because it looks so good. But there are some things that practices, and I'm probably going to do a whole podcast on street food and kind of do's and don'ts, because I'm kind of leery of it, but I'm getting more comfortable with it. So this site gives you good information about how to be careful eating it. Bug bite prevention. We don't think about bugs very, I mean, we do down south because we have a lot of mosquitoes. But besides that, when you travel, you don't totally think about that till you go somewhere and you go, oh my God, these gnats or the mosquitoes or whatever, and you don't have your bug spray or whatever, and you have to go out and get some, or you put yourself a little bit or a lot in harm's way. Then also a whole section about how you get medical care when you're traveling, which I'm going to go into this topic a little bit more later, but it's such a good website. And I basically, to kind of highlight it even more, I'm going to go over, I recently traveled to Mexico City, and this website has a great checklist called Mexico Healthy Travel Packing List. This is wonderful.
Oh, perfect.
Oh, yeah. This is wonderful. I mean, this website is fantastic. But on this Mexico Healthy Travel Packing List, the first section, you basically have your med list. If you're taking medicines or whatever, you need to get your prescriptions, put them in your bag, and make sure you have all of that. Then travelers' anti-diarrhea meds or antibiotics. When you go to Mexico, oh, you have to be very careful, because You could eat one piece of lettuce that is the killer. And those upset stomachs in Mexico, for people who are not used to it, can set you back a couple of days, and they are very painful. Also, altitude sickness meds. Many places in Mexico are quite high up, and people definitely experience a lot of tiredness, some dizziness, and it can elevate your numbers, your blood pressure, etc., when you're up high. Malaria prevention or malaria prescriptions, they'll recommend that if you're going to certain areas. So all of this is very good. Then the next section, they just have additional medical supply list, glasses and a pair of spares if you wear glasses or contact lenses and spares, diabetic test supplies and insulin or if you're a diabetic, inhalers, medical alert bracelets or necklaces. And they even have apps now with your phone that you can download. Then any over-the-counter meds. Now, I know myself, I suffer from horrible allergies. And that is what gets me the most when I travel. So now I definitely travel with some over-the-counter meds that my doctor has told me to take. And it really makes a difference. And I'm not a doctor, so whatever I'm sharing with you is my experiences or something that I follow myself that is from a reputable source. But one of my experiences is I love aspirin. If I don't feel well or I'm feeling kind of droopy or tired, I take two aspirins, and that's all my aching body really needs. Lots of people can't tolerate aspirin. Tylenol or Advil works for them, and they feel more comfortable with that. But it really does help with the achy feet. And when you travel after a couple of days and you've done a lot of walking and you've seen a lot of things and you've eaten a lot of food, your body really is kind of a little bit in a state of shock because you're not used to all of this, you know, and you're having to adjust and you get more tense. Well, for me, I have bad feet, so my feet and knees and hips hurt, and my upper back hurts. If I just take two aspirins, it is amazing how I feel so much better. I feel almost like normal. So I'm not saying aspirin is what you have to have, but if you like Tylenol or Advil, this is in my list of additional medical supply. Okay, then supplies to prevent illness or injury. Hand sanitizer, sunscreen, condoms, and a small first aid kit. Now, it doesn't have to be a big first aid kit, but you might want to have a few things available, especially if you're going to a third world country. And there might be some other things on this list. I know that I twist my ankle very easily. I've done this since I was a young child. So if I'm staying away a long time and I know I'm going to be walking a lot, I have these socks that I pull up that are kind of ankle braces.
Like the compression socks?
But they're much stronger, okay. Strictly for the ankle top of the foot. I have one of those gizmos that you could wrap around and all that kind of stuff. But the socks work better. And the next section is health documents you need. Of course, your health insurance, a copy of the policy, and usually now all health insurers, they'll email you the policy. You can request them to send you a paper copy, but you can print your own copy from the email. But it's good to have a hard copy with you as well as the email in your phone that you can access readily. As I shared, copies of prescriptions, contact information. You need to have written down either on this checklist or in your journal. And when I talk about journal, for every trip that I do, I put in a little journal where I'm staying, my name, my family information, all the things that I want to do. I have a sample itinerary for every day. Then I use it to write down some of my observations and thoughts while I'm on the trip. But these little small journals that I use, I do record this kind of information in it because it's always in my backpack or my tote or whatever. So put your family or make sure you have written down somewhere your family contact information, your doctor's contact information, and all your healthcare providers, including your hotel information, a list of suggested hospitals and clinics. You might get in a car accident and you're still coherent, but you can't find your phone. You don't have a, if you have that list written down that the U.S. State Department or the Center for Disease Control shared, you know the hospitals that are approved or recommended. And then you can tell them, I want to go here, or which one of these is the nearest. And then also you need to have the U.S. embassies, if you're a U.S. citizen, if you're a citizen of another country, obviously your country, their embassy address and phone number. I think this is really a great list to help you be prepared health-wise before a trip. And like I said, make sure you write down all this information. First of all, you can go down the list and check. I've got this, this, this. And then you have this together if you've got some kind of emergency or even a smaller health event. So this is all good, smart health practices. The next one is, and here again, I'm not a doctor, but this is what I do. And lots of people do it, and it was actually recommended to me about 8 years ago, and I started doing it. But there is a over-the-counter product called Emergency, and what it is a really big dose of vitamin C. And Emergency is basically used to boost your immune system. And supposedly, if you start taking it 3 weeks ahead of time, of which that's what I do, it really gets your immune system in good shape before your trip and during your trip. And this is very important because I have found that I am more likely to get sick en route, on the planes, in the airports, than actually where I am. So I use Emergency. Check with your doctor, make sure you can, but this is something that's really good that a lot of people use. Okay, then the next tip is you got to have those good walking shoes, especially if you're a solo traveler, and you'll get on the trolleys and the metro, depending on how comfortable you are doing all of that, but you do walk a lot when you travel, especially solo. So if you don't have good shoes, you're going to get blisters. Your feet are going to just kill you day three. Then, like I said, your knees and your hips and the older you are, everything really starts aching. So those walking shoes are a must. And there are a lot of places now that you go and they're older areas, cobblestones. And some of the cobblestones are really killers. I just went to San Miguel de Allende in Mexico. And I'm telling you, those are probably some of the roughest. It seems like the whole town is done with cobblestones. It's pretty tough. So good walking shoes, that's part of the health preparedness that you need to do. As well as I shared with you my ankle sock. I mean, some people, you know, they might even have a slight little, I don't want to say back brace or something. You know your own issues in your body. So if you know you're going to be away from home a while and you're going to be overexerting yourself, make sure you carry that.
I know that when you start looking at some of the travel products, you'll see little travel lumbar supports and travel neck pillows, not just for sleeping, but for actual supporting your neck. All those kinds of things are available.
Yeah. And you don't actually think about it, but you need to. Yeah, because then you're going to be craving it. Once your body starts talking back to you, that's when you become more vulnerable to something getting a lot worse. You know, either really twisting your ankle or maybe fainting or whatever. So you need to kind of be prepared for some of that. The next one is along the same lines, appropriate clothing. Obviously, you've got to dress appropriate for the weather. Whether it's really hot, you need natural cotton, linen fabrics. And this is a must. If you go to some of the areas where it's extremely humid and extremely hot, the minute you walk outside, you start sweating and it's rolling off of your body. You're going to be so uncomfortable if your clothes do not breathe, they're loose fitting, etc. So that's very important. Even if you wear the same thing three times in a row, it's going to be much better than two outfits that might be cute, but they're not the right fabric. And then, of course, if it's winter or if it's very cold or extremely cold, you have to make sure that you've got the right clothing, too, so you don't hurt yourself with all of that. And then things like the circulate, you talked about the neck things, the compression socks, and anything that you feel like would address what you would need while you're away in terms of health to make sure that you stay healthy. Okay, and then the last one is really the first day you get anywhere, I always say take it easy. I mean, if you've had a long flight or an overnight flight, like what I always do if I'm going over the pond, the Atlantic, and wherever I stop, especially if I've never been there, I always try to take the hop-on, hop-off buses because they might be a little too touristy for some people, but they are a very good way to sit back, relax, get your bearings all over the city. You don't have to hop on and hop off. Just sit there, put the earphones on, get on the top floor, let the wind blow in your hair, listen to the music, and like I said, the commentary. It'll be a nice way to kind of not lose a day, but not really wear yourself out. So at night, you can be extremely tired because you've been up almost 2 days and you'll crash. And the next day, you can get up and get on their time. And if you have to, sleep in a little bit later. Just get over that initial jet lag. Because if you don't ever get over it, oh, then your sinuses like mine. Whenever I'm overtired, oh, my sinuses go berserk. So that's really important. Or say you get in midday or end of the day. What I've done before is that when I know that, I will contact the hotel prior to it. If they have a spa there, I'll have a massage lined up or something, or I might swim laps or whatever. And if they don't have one there, they can recommend one that's close to me. That is so wonderful. I'll never forget. My daughter and I went to St. Petersburg, Russia, over the holidays a couple of years ago. And in Russia, they have something called the banya. And the banya is a steam bath type of experience, but you have an attendant in there that actually, well, I don't want to say beat you, but they take these birch branches that are dipped in very hot water and they tap on your back in all kinds of different rhythms and different strengths, and they do different moves and everything. And this is something that's cultural in Russia as well, as it's very therapeutic. And it's so relaxing. So we had the banya. After the banya, you go and swim in a colder pool. And then we had a massage. I mean, by the time we were through with that 3.5 hours, we were like wet noodles. We slept. In fact, my daughter said, "You snored so much, Mama, I couldn't take it." But that's a good strategy. Just go to the spa, get a massage, or, you know, go sit in the hot tub or whatever. It'll help you relax. So bottom line is, don't let yourself get exhausted. And so take it easy that first day.
That was the good. Well, despite our best efforts, we're not feeling so great. We're in the bad category. What are the most common health problems that might befall our solo travelers, and what tips do you have for us in this bad situation?
Well, bad. Yeah, bad sounds pretty bad, but it could be a lot worse.
Oh, we'll get to worse.
No, most of these tips really are going to be common sense, and they're what you would do if you were at home. But you need to kind of think about it before. How would I handle this if I do get this or that and the other? So I'm going to go over them just briefly. Typically, the types of bad situations or what you'll be facing are a cold, then it going into the flu, or here again, my sinus attacks, which, oh my God, my nose will actually run like a, I hate to say this, like a faucet. It's unbelievable sometimes the allergens in certain places. I remember in Morocco, my eyes and my nose, oh, it was just horrible.
Yeah. Well, like you said, it's just you're not used to any of it.
No.
It's all new antibodies, everything's
Yeah. Stomach issues, that Montezuma's revenge, or actually food poisoning. And food poisoning you can get. I've gotten it a few times, not a lot, but when you get it, oh, God, you know, you're sweating. You're like going, oh, God, I don't know if I can take this anymore.
It's the worst.
So it's not fun. Your blood pressure might go up some, especially for people who have high blood pressure, and you might feel lightheaded or dizzy. A toothache. Now, a lot of people don't even think about this. And that's another thing in the pre-planning that you should do besides the physical checkup if you haven't had one. If you haven't been to the doctor or dentist for a while, just go get a checkup. Because I tell you, you get a toothache on the road, that's even worse because you're going to go to a dentist and what is he going to do? And is he going to be good? Is it going to hurt me? Or, you know what I'm saying? If you have a tooth that's kind of almost bad or it's going to have a problem, go ahead and take care of it. And I actually did that. I have a wisdom tooth in the back that I have a crown on and it kind of cracked. So I had to go get another crown before I left. So make sure you do all that. You don't want to have any bad toothache when you're gone. And then also you could have a panic attack. 25, 30 years ago, I never heard the word. I mean, people might get real nervous, but I mean, like a total panic attack. People just didn't kind of do that. Maybe they did, but now panic attack seems to be like one of the things that can happen, like a toothache. So beware, you might have a panic attack, okay? So these are the things that I think are smart to do if you're in a bad situation. First of all, just go to the local pharmacy. And I tell you, I have done this many times for quick relief. And sometimes some of the things that they give you, like here again in Marrakesh when I was there, and my sinuses were just on fire, nose running. I mean, I couldn't have blown my nose. I probably blew it 500 times in a day. It was horrible. So this tour guide, I was taking a calèche city tour, which is a real fancy carriage that was taking me all around. And he said, would you like me to take you to a pharmacy that I would recommend to help you with your cold or whatever? I said, yes, that's what I really need. So he took me to this pharmacy, a lady pharmacist. She looked at me and diagnosed me and in 2 seconds, oh God. She gave me something to take as well as she put together this little, oh, it had this some kind of menthol eucalyptus crystals in it with some kind of charcoal in this little gauze wrap thing. And she said, now, what you need to do is rub this together a little bit on your hand and then just smell it. Oh, my God. I take 2 whiffs of that. My sinuses would stop. They would all clear up. I would feel so good.
Wow.
Yes. One time in Abu Dhabi, my sinuses were going crazy again. And so I went to this pharmacy in Abu Dhabi and female pharmacist again. And she said, oh, this is what you need to take. She gave me the recommended medicine. But then she gave me 12 vials of liquid royal bee jelly liquid, like the heart of the queen bee, royal bee. And she said, you need to take this. And she said, I tell you, it's going to not only boost your immune system, and she said, but you're going to feel like $1 million. And she said, when you go home, you should really take a royal jelly or some kind. So I do still take it because she said it's very good for women. So go to your pharmacy, first of all. If feeling a little punk in any kind of way, go in there. And you'll get what you need. And maybe it'll even be better than what you get back home. So that's number one. Then number two, if you're starting to really feel bad, like the flu or you're getting dizzy and you're worried about your blood pressure or whatever, you need to take it easy. You really do. And if you have to stay in a day, it's much better than making it go into the ugly and having a heart attack or fainting or something like that. Of course, lots of liquids, soup, no spicy foods, nothing that will make your body be in overdrive. And then the emergency, if you are comfortable with taking that and your doctor says, okay, I love it. Boy, when I'm feeling bad, I'll take some emergency in the morning and I'll take it in the afternoon. So do those things to kind of get over this little hump. Then the third one is go to the hotel concierge. Let the hotel concierge know that you are not feeling well. And if you really feel like you need to see a doctor, you share with him those recommended doctors or clinics that you would like to have an appointment with and get your concierge to make you an appointment. Because if you really feel like you need to go to the doctor and you would here, go ahead and do it while you're on the road. Don't push yourself to the point where, like I said, a bad situation gets ugly.
This is kind of what I was hoping for in this section, is that I think a lot of people, because they feel like their trip is like, I've got to maintain my trip, that they're going to push themselves further or just like try and overcome the cold or power through or whatever, instead of just relaxing and recuperating, and that they're really on that cusp of making things much, much worse if they don't take a slowdown day.
Yes, you have to allow yourself to do that. You might not be able to see everything you want to see, but travel has a funny way of being what it's going to be no matter what. And I think it's all good. I mean, even if you have a bad situation, it's going to be so memorable. I tell you, you will learn something from it. And it was meant to be, basically.
Yeah. That's what I wanted, is your higher level, bigger picture. Just go with it and accept what's happening and don't try and fight it to your detriment.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Because when you get all bent out of shape, everything is downhill. You know that in your normal life. But if you have an appointment with a foreign doctor or you're in a clinic, make sure you bring all of your information that I told you about, your doctor, the meds you take, copies of your prescriptions, everything, your health insurance policy, all of that, so they know everything about you so they can tend to you properly. Then also ask for copies of all the correspondence of what has been done for you, what has been recommended, who you saw, etc., plus any payment receipts, because you might have to have something reimbursed if they don't just take the insurance policy in lieu of money. So be prepared with all of that. Then number four, this is back on that pre-trip checklist, antibiotics, and I bring aspirin, but lots of people who travel, they do travel with antibiotics because when they start feeling a little bit where they could have a flu or something's not right, they'll take antibiotics. First and foremost, get what your doctor recommends you to bring and bring some of that. Like I said, I bring aspirin. But, you know, Tylenol, Advil, whatever. So be prepared with that if your situation is not real good. That might be really all you need, with a little extra rest and a lot more water. I have found that drinking water, and of course you have to drink the bottled water, but drinking water is wonderful. It flushes your system out. You don't feel as tired. That dehydration is a silent killer. You don't know it, but you are dehydrated. And I'm like that a lot because I don't really like water. But I force myself to drink it, especially when I'm traveling. Okay, number five. Visit U.S. recommended hospital or clinic for attention for a minor accident. If you have something that is more than just the flu or sinuses or whatever, like a broken arm, or say you cut yourself and you need stitches, any problem that you really have to have tended to, go ahead and get it tended. Don't just try to wrap it up real good with five Band-Aids. Go ahead and get those few stitches. And then follow the doctor's orders and cut back on your activities if you have to. So you can't quite take part with all these things that you want to do. You might just want to sit down and discuss with the concierge, how can I accomplish these things and make sure I don't overdo it with this sprained ankle or now that I'm on crutches or whatever. And they can say, well, I'll get you a driver and a guide or just a driver, and he'll take you to all the places you want to go to. So you don't have to be on a tour bus. You don't have to be going in and out of cabs or Ubers, worrying about how you're going to get here or there. We'll take care of all of that for you. The guide will help you or the driver in and out of the car, etc. That could make the whole trip be great again. So put that in the back of your mind, that there's always that option for you to use a driver and a guide. It might be a little bit more expensive. In third world countries, it's not expensive, I think, at all. But in Europe or some of the more industrialized countries, it could be expensive. But that is an option. And then last, this is also an option. You can go home. Unfortunately, that's not going to be your favorite one, but you can. If you don't feel good and you just, in your mind, you feel like your trip really is over, it's okay to go home. I know you've spent money and you'll be disappointed, but just let it go. Something else down the line, it will resurface, and it just wasn't meant to be. So know that you could go home, too. That is an option.
We'll count that as plan Z. How about that?
I mean, you know, I've never had to do that. But the older I get, I probably have a lot more common sense than I did when I was young. I mean, because I really, you know, whew, if I made this plan, I was going to work my plan. Some kind of way I was going to figure it out. But sometimes that might really not be what you should do. You might need to go home. There might be a reason, too, why home is calling you. So,
you know, one thing I haven't heard you mention is travel insurance. Is illness one of the things that could be covered by travel insurance?
Oh, absolutely. And I'm going to get to that in this last one.
Oh, sorry. Spoiler alert.
Yeah, no. And I mentioned it a little bit in the first part about you have to have travel insurance with good medical care as part of the policy. And like I said at the beginning, if you're in third world countries, you need to have that med evac option, because you never know if you're in some horrific accident or if something happens, those evacuation services can be over 100,000 easy.
Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah. No. And if you don't have the money to pay for it or some kind of insurance policy that it will pay for it, you don't have it. And that could mean life or death to you.
Yeah.
So that's very, very important. And really, you might take the chance of not getting health insurance if you're going to Europe and you have adequate financial assets and you're comfortable with whatever could happen to you, upwards of $500,000 or what. I mean, there's some people that say, yeah, it's no big deal. But for most people, it's a very prudent, small amount of money to have this kind of protection. And it makes a difference in the quality of your trip, because if something goes wrong and you're out $100,000 or whatever, it's awful. And then you don't want to be there and think, oh my God, I don't want to have to spend all that money. So you're in a compromised position trying not to spend money. That's real unwise to do. Now, you can get separate medical travel insurance, but typically the travel insurance policies are with both.
Oh boy, here we go. Unfortunately, things have gotten ugly. Health emergencies can happen while traveling. What do you want solo travelers to know, and what are your tips for health emergencies, Astrid?
Oh, well, this is the nightmare. No solo traveler wants to experience, but it can happen. It really can happen. So you could be in a severe car accident, a victim of some kind of bad physical attack or some kind of terrorist thing, a heart attack, stroke, ultra high fever, severe vomiting. I mean, there are a lot of things in this ugly situation that you really have to get stabilized, because if you don't, it could be life-threatening. So, number one, if you're conscious or coherent, you go straight to the nearest recommended hospital's emergency room. You can do that. You've got those emergency numbers from the CDC, or you could call the U.S. Embassy and get them to give you the numbers if you don't have the numbers. Have the emergency room attendants contact the U.S. Embassy for you. So they will contact your relatives, and they can also give you assistance, because the U.S. Embassy for United States citizens, they will step in until a relative or somebody that you have deemed responsible for your health care to take over. Catherine, you said something about travel insurance. This is when travel insurance is an absolute must. Because say you've got a broken back, a crushed pelvis, you've undergone stitches in your face. I mean, you know, you have sustained a really bad accident. You need to be stabilized, but you probably will want to be air-vacced home as soon as you can. Or if you're in a third world country, you might, or the doctors might think you better get to a more industrialized city where the hospitals have better care. This is when travel insurance is a must. Because if you are in a horrible, horrific accident or something happens to you, you have a crushed pelvis, you break both of your legs, they've had to give you stitches in your face, etc., it might be that your doctors would feel like you need to be in a facility in a more industrialized country. And this medical evac insurance will provide the transport with the nurse attendants, the life support machines on a private jet or some kind of a medical private jet will get you to that nearest hospital or will get you home. Mm. So this is really, really absolute bottom line important to have, unless you're just very, very wealthy, but it's very inexpensive. And then the next one, this is going to sound out there to some people, but you just have to trust in your higher power that you'll get the medical care that you need. So just try to not panic and let them take care of you. But if you don't have the medical insurance or the travel insurance, I can tell you that could be a life-threatening situation. Okay. The next is if you're unconscious, and this is when it's really ugly, you've got to have on your possession a copy of your passport information, whether you have the passport or you've made a photocopy of it. And that means not in your phone. I mean, that means a copy of it. The medical information that I told you about written in your journal or on that medical checklist that you have with you. Your doctor's name, the phone number, the meds you take, the U.S. Embassy contact information, your medical insurance policy carrier and policy number. Here again, you could have it in your phone, but you need at least that cover page to show that you have enforced medical insurance and a family contact information. Now, this needs to be in your possession. It needs to be in your tote, in your backpack, or in your purse at all times. I mean, I know this sounds overkill, and that's why I put it in the little journal, and I have all my little stuff. So if something happens to me, they know enough information to where they can start taking care of me. Once you're coherent, then you can assign somebody basically to help you with the medical care that you will need before a relative can either come home or you can be air-vac'd home or gotten home, stabilized and gotten home. This is all very important because if you don't have this, they might just not tend to you right.
Or in the way that you would want.
Oh, yeah, exactly, exactly. So very important to have this on your possession at all times. Then next, don't panic and don't try to rush home. If you have gotten into some horrible thing, accident, or you're in the hospital with some bad event, let the professionals do what they think is best for you. And just stay until you're stabilized. Because this is very important. A lot of times people think if I don't get home or these people don't know what they're doing, you just have to, at that time, just kind of trust. So that's really all I have in terms of the ugly, because it's really in the hands of the medical professionals and your maker. But I will end this less than exciting, but what I think is highly important podcast for solo travelers with my best tip. Just be prepared. I mean, think like a Boy Scout before you leave, and you never know. This habit of being prepared is going to save your life or really keep you from something very bad happening health-wise. So don't overlook the fact that you can get sick, you can have an accident, break a bone, or end up in a foreign hospital due to some kind of severe health event while traveling. It can happen, and it does happen. So, be healthy before setting out on the trip. Follow that health while traveling abroad checklist that I shared. That's excellent. As CDC has it, country-specific, each one's area. Then, those two websites, the U.S. State Department and the Center for Disease Control. Excellent. Buy health insurance as part of your travel insurance, and specifically that medical evac supplemental coverage if you're going to third world countries for sure. Then don't overexert yourself trying to see and do it all. I know that sounds like, well, I'm going on a vacation. Now, what do you think I'm going to do? I've got to overexert. Well, just know when you feel like you've done too much and pull back. And then last, carry all your pertinent information in your purse, tote, backpack at all times. I can't say this enough. So you will be prepared if needed for a health event. I want to thank everyone for listening. Like I said, I know this was not an exciting podcast, but it really was an important podcast for some basic information that it's important to get into the habit of doing these things to protect from any kind of health issue that you'd have when traveling abroad. I value your comments. If you have any suggestions, please leave them in the comment section. And I would be very happy if you would subscribe. Everybody, you know, all the digital marketing specialists say you have to ask people to subscribe. So I am asking you to subscribe, and if you do, I do truly appreciate it. So I'll say goodbye with, I wish you a lot of future happy and healthy travels.
We went through it all, the good, the bad, and the ugly. But the good is what we wish for you, and one thing to make your travels a little more good. That might not be proper English, but you understand what I'm saying. Astrid has an amazing packing list for you. You heard her go through the list about things that you should include for your medical checklist. Well, she's got an amazing packing list that'll help with everything else. You can get it on her website, astridtravel.com. Right there on the very homepage, there's a place to put in your email, and you can download the packing list right away. We do love our subscribers. Thanks for everybody who's subscribing. Not only does it help you get this valuable information, it actually pushes out the show to more potential solo travelers. We wish you nothing but great health as you travel the world. Thank you so much for listening. We'll see you next time on Solo Travel Talk.
Thank you for listening to Solo Travel Talk. Follow Astrid on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. To learn more about Astrid or her solo travel advisors, visit her website, astridtravel.com.